In this Elden Ring video, I'm going to be showing you why hammers are the best weapon in Elden Ring. This is the 19th video in a series where we go through all the weapons in a given weapon category, show you their pros and cons, and help you make better decisions about why you might want to use them in your build or not. Before we get into the hammers themselves, however, first let's talk about the pros and cons of hammers and the playstyles that I think most people using hammers will use. The pros of this weapon group are that they tend to have very high stance damage, particularly when doing block counters or charged heavy attacks, and they do more stance damage than any weapon in Elden Ring that's not great or colossal. So that's particularly good. If you want to do stance breaks and you like using charged heavy attacks or block counters, then this weapon group is very good. Flails have the same amount of stance damage, and they typically have a little bit more reach when doing block counters, although the angle can be a bit tricky. However, their windup on charged heavy attacks is longer in my experience than hammers. So if you like charged heavy attacks, hammers is better of the two options. The cons of this weapon group is that they can tend to be quite short compared to some other weapons in the game. Their dual wield attacks are not synced, making dual wield not a very viable option for these weapons, and they tend to not have too many status effects on the weapons, though a couple of them do. And talking a little bit about the playstyles I think most people use before we get into the unique hammers themselves, I think most people playing with a hammer will use a great shield or a shield and play a block counter build, particularly because the stance damage on block counters is so good, and because this weapon group has poor dual wield attack animations. Okay, let's take a look at Varre's Bouquet, which is the first unique hammer. Varre's Bouquet shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical damage. It's the lightest hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 2, and requires 8 strength, 16 dexterity, and 24 arcane in order to use. Varre's Bouquet has very, very low attack rating. It's very, very low. It's the second shortest hammer in Elden Ring. It can be difficult to acquire and can be missed if you don't know what to do, and it has some of the highest stat requirements for a hammer. However, it is the lightest hammer, it does have good bleed buildup on hit, and it can be buffed with grease or other weapon buff spells. Its weapon skill, Blood Tax, is not particularly effective since the weapon has such low attack rating and because it has such short reach. It also has a long animation, which makes it susceptible to being interrupted as well, so you likely won't use it that often with this weapon. The sweet spot for this weapon is around 55 arcane and minimum requirements in strength and dexterity, but it does scale decently up to 80 arcane and 50 dex or so. Strength has poor scaling altogether, and I don't recommend investing in it. However, no matter how optimized the damage of this weapon, it still has very low attack rating. The biggest strength of this weapon is that it can set hemorrhage very easily, and leaning into that can work very well, right up until an enemy is immune or very resistant to this status effect. For that reason, I highly recommend splitting your attributes between Faith and Arcane in order to be able to cast the incantations effectively, Dragon Communion Seal, and pick up some weapon buffs that can really help your attack rating. This gives you the option to rely more on your spells for damage than your bouquet, but you can use your bouquet to charge up your attack power via things like Lord of Blood's Exaltation, White Mask, and things like Millicent's Prothesis and Rotten Winged Sword Insignia before casting a hard-hitting spell like Dragon Maw, particularly if you were buffed with Golden Vow or Flame Grant Me Strength. Next up, we'll take a look at the Envoy's Horn. The Envoy's Horn shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical and holy damage. It's the third lightest hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 4, and requires 10 strength, 12 dexterity, and 16 faith in order to use. The Envoy's Horn is an interesting hammer. It's one of the shorter hammers in Elden Ring, you can't find it until later in the game. Holy damage isn't a particularly great damage type in the base game, and Oracular Bubble does 100% holy damage. However, it does have decent attack rating, and only 1/3 of its normal attack damage is holy, making it very usable against holy-resistant enemies. Its weapon skill, Oracular Bubble, is why the Envoy's Horn is a decent weapon. It shoots out a bubble of 100% holy damage over a moderate distance that deals significant damage for its cost of 6 FP. This allows you to use this to pick off enemies fairly easily or soften up hard-to-kill targets safely at range. And because Oracular Bubble deals 100% holy damage, it's buffed easily by Holy Shrouding Crack Tear and Sacred Scorpion Charm for further damage. Additionally, wearing the Envoy Crown will further boost the damage of this skill. The sweet spot for this weapon is at about 40 strength, 40 dexterity, and 20 faith, but the weapon scales decently with strength and dexterity up to 55 or so, with faith lagging behind a bit. However, neither strength nor dexterity boost the damage of Oracular Bubble, but faith does. This means if you're building for Oracular Bubble damage, you'll be sacrificing a bit of melee damage, about 30 points, but that's not too bad. I highly recommend building this weapon that way, increasing strength and faith with minimum dex in order to 1. Boost Oracular Bubble damage, 2. Allow you to use a great shield effectively, 3. Take advantage of the Clawmark Seal for incantations, and 4. Give you enough faith for Golden Vow and other buffs or spells you might want. Up next is the Nox Flowing Hammer. The Nox Flowing Hammer shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical damage. It's the second heaviest hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 6.5, and requires 17 strength and 7 dexterity in order to use. The Nox Flowing Hammer is the shortest hammer in Elden Ring, and you can't find it until fairly far into the game. But it does have pretty high attack rating, it scales with strength very well, allowing for a great shield pairing easily, and its weapon skill Flowing Form is quite deadly. Flowing Form swings the hammer in a medium-ish wide sweep that tends to cause enemies to flinch before pancaking them into the dirt. This allows you to chain it over and over, not allowing the enemy a chance to respond if you can land the first hit a lot of the time, provided you have the stamina to keep using it. Its damage is also passable for its 16 FP cost, and it will trigger Winged Sword Insignia, Rotten Winged Sword Insignia, and Millicent's Prothesis if it hits multiple enemies. Attribute-wise, the sweet spot is right around 55 strength and minimum dexterity, but it scales well up to 80 strength. You can continue to pump dex after this for marginal damage, allowing you to take this weapon into Journey 2 effectively, but past that, its damage will suffer. However, this might not matter if you stunlock everything with Flowing Form. I like to play this weapon with a great shield to block counter. This allows you to use something like Assassin's Cerulean Dagger to help offset FP costs if you want, and you can use Warrior Jar Shard or Shard of Alexander to further boost Flowing Form damage. I also like to use Ritual Sword Talisman for this build, as you tend to not get hit very often when using this weapon skill. Up next is the Ringed Finger. The Ringed Finger shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical damage. It has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 4.5, and requires 15 strength and 9 dexterity in order to use. The Ringed Finger isn't found until pretty far into the game, but it is tied with the Hammer and Scepter of All-Knowing for the longest hammer in Elden Ring. It scales well with strength, allowing for easy great shield pairing, and its weapon skill is pretty solid. Claw Flick expands the finger for a second or so before flicking the enemy forward, often launching them into the air if it doesn't outright kill them. The damage it deals is decent for its 14 FP cost, and it can be used somewhat easily even at short range because it causes enemies to flinch when it expands, preventing damage a lot of the time. I like to use this right after a block counter since Claw Flick also does 30 stance damage, allowing you to stance break more difficult enemies easily with this combo. The sweet spot for this weapon is around 55 strength and a minimum requirements into dexterity, but it scales well up to 80 strength. You can get some damage out of dex, but it's not a ton, making this weapon do alright in Journey 2, but probably not further than that unless you go for stance breaks. I like to play this weapon with a great shield to block counter, which allows you to use something like Assassin's Cerulean Dagger to help offset FP costs. Again, Warrior Jar Shard and Shard of Alexander further boost Claw Flick damage, so make sure you have those. And also make sure you have at least 51 poise on your armor, so that if you get hit while using Claw Flick, you don't get interrupted. The Scepter of All-Knowing has unique thrusting variants on some of its weapon attacks, and deals physical and magic damage. It has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 4.5, and requires 12 strength, 18 dexterity, and 21 intelligence in order to wield. Even though the Scepter of All-Knowing is tied for the longest hammer in Elden Ring, and it's the only unique hammer that has a thrusting variant, you still cannot use it until very late into the game, and it has high requirements for a hammer, and its weapon skill is not very good. Knowledge Above All debuffs nearby enemies and yourself, reducing magic and holy negation by 10% for 60 seconds for a whopping 35 FP to use. Since the weapon itself deals about 40% magic damage, that's only a 5% increase to melee attacks, making it better suited to debuff bosses or a large group of enemies before spellcasting. However, considering its rather short range and cost, you'd likely be better off just casting another spell for 35 FP most of the time. The sweet spot for this weapon is around 50 dex and minimum requirements in strength and intelligence, but intelligence does not scale terribly up to 50, and you can get some points out of strength as well, which you might want to in order to use a better shield. However, I find that the damage you lose from pumping int instead of dex isn't too bad, which allows you to use better staves and cast sorceries with higher potency. This weapon should be fine damage-wise at least through Journey 2, but it might struggle beyond that, mostly because of its poor weapon skill. Consider using this weapon with a staff in order to cast sorceries, using the scepter only to debuff or melee when necessary. You can use a shield as well to get some block counters for one-on-one situations, and when paired with Great Blade Phalanx, you can get some easy stance breaks. And then we come to the last unique hammer, Marika's Hammer. Marika's Hammer shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical and holy damage. It's one of the heavier hammers in Elden Ring, weighing 6 and requires 20 strength, 12 dexterity, and 19 faith in order to use. Marika's Hammer is one of the shorter hammers in Elden Ring. You can't find it until the very end of the game, making it a Journey 2 weapon. It has high requirements for a hammer, and it does some holy damage, which many base game bosses are resistant to. However, it has the highest attack rating of all unique hammers. Most of the damage is physical, and it has one of the deadliest weapon skills in Elden Ring. Goldbreaker causes your character to leap forward into the air, slamming your hammer down in a rather large AoE, dealing both physical and holy damage that tends to make enemies flinch. What makes this skill so great is two things. First, if you make it into the air, you're virtually uninterruptible, allowing you to spam this skill rather easily since enemies flinch when struck most of the time, giving you time to use it back to back. And second, if you connect with both the hammer itself and the AoE, you will deal 40 stance damage, allowing you to stance break the majority of bosses in Elden Ring in 2 hits with a bit of practice and a little luck. The sweet spot for this weapon is around 50 strength with minimum requirements in dexterity and faith. However, it's a good idea to make sure you have at least 25 faith in order to use Golden Vow and Flame Grant Me Strength. This weapon scales decently with all 3 stats though, and since its skill is so good, you'll be able to get through at least Journey 2 and 3 and possibly higher than that with it. I like to play this weapon with the Great Shield for block counters and the Clawmark Seal to take advantage of both Strength and Faith for incantations, leaning into Goldbreaker like I did in my Goldbreaker build. So next up are the Infusible Hammers, starting with the Club. The Club has an R1 attack chain that operates just like the Stone Club, striking rapidly and deals physical damage. It has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring Wing 5 and requires 10 strength in order to use. The Club is longer than most hammers in Elden Ring. It can be found extremely early in the game. It has the lowest stat requirements of all hammers, and it attacks very quickly compared to other hammers. However, it does have the lowest attack rating of all infusible hammers. Its weapon skill Barbaric Roar is not bad and further increases the physical damage you do with the weapon, as well as strength scaling for 40 seconds, and changes your heavy attacks into a chain. This attack chain is very strong, but you do need good poise in order to pull it off successfully. Infusion-wise, Sacred and Flame Art and Fire and Lightning are virtually tied at 601 and 600 attack rating, with Magic pulling up 3rd and 596. Heavy edges out Keen, 560 to 539, with Cold being a valid option at 550. I like to play this weapon with the highest attack rating I can since it's low to begin with, so I usually go with Fire. This provides good strength scaling that helps you also use a great shield for block counters. You can pick any Ash of War you like, but two good ones for this build are Flaming Strike for extra damage or Lion's Claw for stance breaks. Lion's Claw does 39 stance damage with hammers, which is higher than all great weapons and colossal weapons that are not also hammers. Remember that this weapon attacks very quickly for a hammer, so using talismans like Winged Sword Insignia or Millicent's Prosthesis are definitely viable on this weapon. Next is the Curved Club. The Curved Club shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical damage, and has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring weighing 5, and requires 11 strength and 7 dexterity in order to use. On initial inspection, the Curved Club doesn't look that great. It is one of the shorter hammers in Elden Ring, and it has lower attack rating than a lot of other infusible hammers. However, you can get it early on in the game, and it has rather good strength scaling, making it ideal to use with a great shield. And just like the Club, it has the weapon skill Barbaric Roar, which is not a bad choice as long as you have decent poise. Infusion-wise, Magic comes in first at 656 attack rating, with Sacred and Flame Art second at 638, and Fire and Lightning a close third at 634. However, Heavy is not that far behind at 620, outperforming Keen by 45 points. I like to use this weapon with a heavy infusion since it's not that far behind the top 3 and allows you to buff the weapon with Barbaric Roar more effectively by keeping the weapon all physical damage, but also allows you to use a great shield pretty easily with it. And if you don't use Barbaric Roar, you can always buff your weapon with the Grease as well, pushing you over the other infusions and damage when you need it most. Up next is the Spiked Club. The Spiked Club has a unique R2 attack and deals physical damage. It has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring weighing 5 and requires 12 strength and 7 dexterity in order to use. The Spiked Club is one of 3 hammers with native bleed buildup on it. It can be found extremely early on in the game, and it is actually decent quality scaling that makes it great for a Journey 2 playthrough. However, it is one of the shorter hammers in Elden Ring, and you don't trigger hemorrhage nearly as often as you'd hope when using this weapon. It also has the weapon skill Barbaric Roar, which is not bad, again, as long as you have poise, but it's particularly good on this weapon because of the bleed buildup that can often trigger from the attack chain that changes when buffing with this Ash of War. Infusion-wise, Sacred and Flame Art come in first at 675, with Magic just behind at 673, and Fire and Lightning just behind that at 670. Heavy outperforms Keen 604 to 576, with Cold doing 593. However, Quality comes in here at 573, which is not that far behind either Keen or Heavy, meaning it should easily overtake either of these infusions in Journey 2, where you can take Strength and Dexterity up to 80-80 with better results. Because Fire is pretty far ahead of Heavy in terms of attack rating, I recommend taking this infusion here in order to take advantage of that, and still use a Great Shield easily due to strength scaling. You could also go the Cold route if you want to have duo status effects, because Cold also scales well with strength. Up next is the Stone Club. The stone club has an R1 attack chain that operates just like the club, striking rapidly and deals physical damage. It is the heaviest hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 7, and requires 16 strength and 8 dexterity in order to use. The stone club slaps hard and should be considered by any player looking to use a hammer in Elden Ring. It's one of the longest hammers, it can be found somewhat early in the game, it attacks more quickly than most other hammers, and it has the highest potential attack rating of all hammers in the game. The only drawbacks are that it is the heaviest hammer, weighing 7, and kick is not a great weapon skill in PvE. Kick is not particularly good since it's used to open up shield-wielding enemies and players to critical attacks by breaking their guard. However, there are not that many enemies that this applies to, and usually you can just wait for those enemies to attack you and block counter, so I highly recommend swapping this to another weapon skill when you can. Infusion-wise, Fire and Lightning comes in first at 718 attack rating, with Magic a close second at 714, and Sacred and Flame Art coming in at 685. Heavy outperforms Keen 660 to 641, and Cold actually outperforms Heavy, making it a good choice since it still has good strength scaling, and you can attack quickly with this weapon, triggering Frostbite fast in many cases. I like to play this weapon with very high attack rating with Flaming Strike and the Fire Infusion because you can hit close to 900 attack rating when set up this way with Ritual Sword Talisman, which is very high for a weapon that weighs 7. Additionally, you could use the Jellyfish Shield to further buff your damage while also using block counters. Up next is the Mace. The Mace has a unique R2 attack and deals physical damage. It has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 4.5, and requires 12 strength and 7 dexterity in order to use. The Mace is neither a fantastic weapon nor a poor one. It's one of the shorter hammers in Elden Ring, but you can purchase it in Roundtable Hold early on, and it has decent attack rating. As with the Stone Club, Kick is not a particularly good weapon skill, so I highly recommend swapping this to another one when you can. Any of the ones I've mentioned so far are fine. Infusion-wise, Sacred and Flame Art comes in first at 660, with Magic virtually tied at 658 and Fire and Lightning just behind at 654. Heavy outperforms Keen 609 to 587, with Cold coming in at 599. I like to play this weapon with a Sacred or Flame Art infusions and a Great Shield to get that traditional Paladin feeling. You can split attributes between Strength and Faith to use a Great Shield and the Clawmark Seal to cast spells like Golden Vow, which really helps you to crank up your damage. I also really like the Lightning slash Ash of War for this weapon since it does have Sacred as an infusion option and still buffs the weapon, and you can also use it easily after a stance break or sometimes after a block counter. Next up is the Morning Star. The Morning Star shares a thrusting attack at the end of its R1 attack change as well as a rolling R1 with the Scepter of All Knowing, but deals physical damage. It has an average weight for a hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 5, and requires 12 strength and 8 dexterity in order to use. The Morning Star is not the most powerful hammer in Elden Ring, and it's quite short, but it does have bleed buildup on hit, and it can be found quite early, and it's a decent quality scaling weapon, making it good for Journey 2. As with the Stone Club and Mace, Kick is not a particularly good weapon skill, so I highly recommend swapping this to another one when you can. Any of the ones I suggested so far are good. Infusion-wise, Magic and Sacred and Flame Art are tied at 662 attack rating, with Fire and Lightning coming in second. Keen outperforms Heavy with this hammer, but only by 3 attack rating, and Cold is just behind at 566. Quality is not far behind that either, at 564. I like to play this weapon with the Heavy Infusion, dipping a few points into Faith and Arcane in order to use Blood Flame Blade with it, or just use Blood Grease, otherwise you don't see much result from the bleed effect, which normally only triggers maybe once per boss fight. This also allows you to crank strength and use a Great Shield as well for block counters. Next is the Warpick. The Warpick shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical damage. It's the second lightest hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 2.5 and requires 11 strength and 9 dexterity in order to use. The Warpick is an interesting hammer because it's extremely lightweight at 2.5. It does piercing damage instead of strike despite what the weapon displays, and it can be found early in the game. The biggest downside, and it's a big one, is that it has very low attack rating for a hammer, second only to Varre's Bouquet. As with the Stone Club, Mace, and Morning Star, Kick is not a particularly good weapon skill, so replace it as soon as you can. Infusion-wise, Magic and Sacred and Flame Art are tied at 599 attack rating, with Fire and Lightning coming in at 585. Keen outperforms Heavy by 6 points, with Cold just behind at 509. I like to play this weapon with a Blood Infusion since its attack rating is so low anyway, which allows you to make up for it somewhat by triggering Hemorrhage on enemies and bosses, and you can use things like White Mask and Lord of Blood's Exaltation to further boost attack power as well. Use a Great Shield for block counters, and make sure to use an Ash of War with good stance damage like Lion's Claw, since this can help make up for the weapon's attack rating. Up next is the Hammer. The Hammer shares the default attack of other hammers and deals physical damage. It's the second heaviest hammer in Elden Ring, weighing 6.5, and requires 14 strength and 7 dexterity in order to use. The Hammer is a solid choice for this weapon group because of its very high attack rating and the fact that it is the second longest hammer in Elden Ring. However, you cannot get it until very late into the game in the Royal Capital, and it's missable, so you're much more likely that you'll use something else by the time you can get this one. Again, Kick is not a particularly good weapon skill, so I highly recommend swapping this out with another one. Infusion-wise, Fire and Lightning comes in first at 692 attack rating, with Magic just behind at 689, and Sacred and Flame Art at 671. Heavy outperforms Keen 634 to 606, with Cold outperforming Heavy at 643, making it a good choice for this weapon. I like to use this weapon with Fire or Cold for good strength scaling and pair it with a Great Shield. Lion's Claw is just so easy to use with it, and it absolutely destroys enemies because of the decent damage and stance damage per use. However, odds are you will likely be using another hammer unless it's in Journey 2, because that's how late into the game you get it. And the last infusible hammer is the Monk's Flame Mace. The Monk's Flame Mace has a unique R2 attack that stomps the ground and deals physical damage. It's one of the heavier hammers in Elden Ring, weighing 6 and requires 13 strength and 13 dexterity in order to use. The Monk's Flame Mace has solid attack rating for a hammer. It can be found pretty early in Elden Ring, and it has great keen scaling if you want a good dexterity option for a hammer. And again, Kick is not a particularly good weapon skill on it, so I highly recommend replacing it as soon as you can. Infusion-wise, Magic comes in first at 685 attack rating, then Fire and Lightning at 682, and finally Sacred and Flame Art at 664. Keen outperforms Heavy by a whopping 43 points, with Cold at 614 attack rating. I like to lean into the Keen aspect of this weapon when using it, though it can make it challenging to use a Great Shield when you have low strength. However, the Jellyfish Shield is fantastic since it only requires 20 strength to use, and it can buff your damage. When paired with the Crag Blade Ash of War, you not only get nearly 1000 attack rating when buffed, but you also get over 40 stance damage with each charged heavy attack, allowing you to stance break most bosses with one block counter and a charged heavy attack, or two charged heavy attacks. Crag Blade is just an all-around fantastic Ash of War for hammers because it pushes them over that 40 charged heavy attack threshold for stance damage, which allows you to stagger most bosses in two hits with any hammer. So that wraps up our video for hammers in Elden Ring. I hope you guys learned some things in this video. I really like this weapon group. When doing this video, it's not a weapon group that I anticipated liking, but the more I played with it, the more I really, really enjoy hammers. And I think they are a very overlooked weapon type in this game. So what did I miss? Make sure you guys share your tips in the comments below. And if you have questions, please leave them here and I'll try and answer them as soon as I can. I will be trying to wrap up these videos before we get into the Shadow of the Erdtree DLC. We also have more Elden Ring content just around the corner.